And I think we'll get started. And what I would like to do today is the quiz three review. I just did get these graded just this afternoon. And so here is the list of subjects. And so you see the Niobid crater, the Kallax crater with the Ajax and all that. That was the number one. The Chimera, the Capitoline wolf, the Parthenon, and the Scraper. There were three no submissions, and I'll want to talk to you guys about that here. And two, the Standard of Ur, and I need to talk about that one too. And so I put here some good examples of your answers. I just kind of picked from the best. The Parthenon and here is part of the answer. This was a long one, so it takes two slides, but let me share with you. The Parthenon was a temple dedicated to Athena, constructed entirely out of marble on the Acropolis in Athens. Acropolis should probably be capitalized. It's 101 feet long by 208 feet wide. It was built by Ikatinos. And as I like to point out, if you guys look at older sources, they'll have Ikatinos and Callicrates as the architects, and they've kind of settled that it's going to be here.
What's Ikatinos?
That's his name. Yeah, it's Greek. It's kind of odd.
I thought it was like a group of people or something.
Right. And see, when they had two people, it seemed to make more sense. And especially when the name ends with an S. Yeah, I could see that. Around 447, 438 BCE to commemorate Athens' victory over the Persians, and it still stands there today. I think the Parthenon is a perfect representation of the Greeks' perception of beauty as well as their values. Athens was one of the first city-states to have a democratic government and was arguably ahead of its time in both technology and culture. Using mathematics to calculate the exact dimensions of the Parthenon fits with the Athenians' values on higher learning and sophistication. This triumph, quote, civilization over savagery, their victory against the Persians, was the inspiration behind the temple's construction. Furthermore, it is dedicated to Athena, the goddess of wisdom. In a culture that where wisdom and knowledge are valued and praised, it is only fitting that their art and architecture reflects that. Many of the pediments on the Parthenon show scenes. Actually, there's only like two pediments. I think what they're probably talking about is the metopes, friezes along the bottom and stuff, but at any rate, I didn't get too picky on these. And so chains of forces of order prevailing against the savage foes, such as the gods of Olympus defeating the Titans. The columns also reflect this idea of order using the algebraic formula X equals 2Y plus 1 to build 8 columns on the short side and 17 on the long side. See, 8 times 2 plus 1, 17. Anyway, the 4-9 ratio when designing Parthenon's dimensions is a perfect example of how Athenians applied logic to create something superior in beauty. And so that's quite an opinion. That's an informed opinion, I think. And so paragraph 1, long paragraph 2, And this is paragraph three, finding something that backs up your opinion. That's math, which is this site right here from https://thatsmaths.com. Articulates these points well. The Parthenon shows how brilliantly the Greeks had mastered geometric principles. They saw mathematics as a means to understand the divine. And so ideal order and beauty and math and learning and knowledge, they were all kind of tied up in the same thing. That was more or less their religion kind of encompassed all of that. And so, in the Athenian eyes, divinity and ideal proportions were connected. It has been argued that the facade of the Parthenon has proportions of the golden ratio. That's something we didn't talk about here. Anybody ever heard of the golden ratio?
Is this something to do with math?
Kind of. Has something to do with geometry, and it was used for two-dimensional art, and it was a calculation to create the ideal composition. Yeah, that's why we didn't talk about it, especially because we don't have any Greek paintings to demonstrate that. We have the golden ratio, and it shows up again during the Renaissance, but anyway. But it was a good point, and widely held to be the most aesthetically pleasing shape. Well, I would use the word composition, but bottom line, these ideal proportions were utilized to add to the Parthenon's beauty. Within the treasury of the Parthenon stood an 11-meter statue of Athena, carved in ivory with armor of pure gold, while the most important goddess in Greek religion, Athena was important to the Athenians to the point of their city being named after her. Their interest in wisdom and knowledge results in this temple to Athena to be extremely well suited to the goddess. So he's got some quotes in here from That's Math's good example. It's probably one of the longest ones. And I didn't take off for it being too short, unless it was like really, really short and didn't say enough. But here's example two. The capital of team wolf, and a lot of you in this section wrote about this too. Parthenon, not so much. Capitoline wolf. In Italy, called Lupa Capitolina. Lupa means wolf, by the way. Is a sculpture cast from bronze. I'm going to move this up. This famous sculpture depicts a scene that is part of the legend of the founding of Rome. The sculpture shows a she-wolf suckling Romulus and Remus, the mythical twin fathers. And see, this is all still a subject matter, but that's okay. The twins were abandoned and rescued by a she-wolf that cared for them until a herdsman, Faustulus, found and raised them. Now we're talking about the actual dimensions, 75 centimeters by 114 centimeters, currently on display at the Musee Capitolini, located in Rome. The age of the Capitoline wolf is controversial because the wolf statue was thought to be of the 5th century BC when the twins were added in late 15th century AD. However, recent radiocarbon dating has found the wolf statue was most likely cast between 1021 and 1153. And so we talked a little bit about the dates, and in the tag, in the identification of this on the slide and in the textbook, kind of has some question marks about it. I'm not sure that the radiocarbon dating has been quite accepted. And in part, I think, because there are some issues about carbon when you're casting metal, because you have fire, it's a lot of carbon, so on. Likewise, there's another artifact, the Shroud of Turin, which was thought to be the cloth that Jesus was wrapped in when he was crucified. And they talk about the carbon dating, which kind of puts it into the medieval times around the same time. But there was a fire in the church where this shroud had been kept a few hundred years ago. And there's some speculation that those are the kinds of things that could mess up radiocarbon tests. I don't know, but this is all spelled out and I like this. This is like really good. And so the second paragraph, I believe the Capuletine wolf sculpture is historically significant. The legend of the twins, Romulus and Remus, has been told countless times. When a sculpture finally created a visual representation, and that probably should be sculptor instead of sculpture, but you know, I didn't get that picky into the weeds. It was only reinforced and embraced by the culture. With such a strong backstory to the piece, the legend behind it, the sculpture has altered people's view of Rome, including its eternal symbol that continues to live on to this day. And so here's some supporting third paragraph information in an article on the website, Khan Academy. Dr. Jacqueline Neal wrote, "The image of this miracle quickly became a symbol of the city of Rome, appearing on coinage in the 3rd century BCE. So this is kind of another thing when we start talking about dates. Was there other representations? I don't know, but she's right. And it did appear on the coinage and continued to appear on public monuments from trash cans. I'm not sure that a trash can is a public monument, but it's kind of like in St. Louis, the fleur-de-lis that you see inside the yellow, the blue fleur-de-lis inside the yellow circle on a red background with the two rivers forming into one for St. Louis. That's big. The arch being another big symbol of St. Louis. And so Romulus and Remus, you find it in Rome in a similar way. This legend is historically significant because the scene has become the eternal symbol of Rome. So again, another good entry. I could pick on it a little bit, but it's really pretty good. And I get the idea that this author understands the subject. And this is something that a bunch of you guys wrote about in this section, the Neobid crater. And the Neobid painter crater, see, this is something where this was kind of came up in a lot of the different submissions, because it's really kind of confusing. The Neobid painter, and sometimes they call this the Neobid crater, sometimes it refers to the painter, and the painter painted the Neobids. So it's all kind of blurry how we use the language on this. And again, I didn't get too picky. This person settled it by using a backslash. But at any rate, was an ancient Athenian-based painter in the red style figure who was active from approximately 470, 450 BCE. He is named after a calyx crater which shows the god Apollo and his sister Artemis killing the children of Niobe.
Oh my.
What? Yeah.
Oh, she said
I'm lying. Yep. these are, a lot of this is in the Greek art, in Roman art too, really pretty brutal. They were, and we'll talk about that a little bit when we talk about Rome, because Rome kind of brought it to a whole different level.
Is it like because of the war that kind of caused like slaughtering children and stuff?
Well, yeah, I think that that's a good question. I think that there, through the centuries, there have been a different, there have been different ideas about the sanctity of life and of people. And so, like Romulus and Remus, they were abandoned out in the woods. As I was saying earlier, that's what you did with on children, babies you didn't want. You just took them out into the woods. And so the Greeks, they were talking about killing children and stuff. They talk about that in the Bible.
Oh, yeah, they do.
Yeah, that Herod was killing all the babies, but Mary and Joseph and Jesus fled to Egypt when he was a little baby. So yeah, this was kind of real common. They didn't, they had a different idea about what, how sacred life is. And I think that hopefully today, we're starting to get it right. I don't know that we have it all right, but I think that the good people in the world can keep pushing this. And so anyway, and we have, I think, well, there's a lot of things. You know, if I remember back when I was your age, because I'm old, we didn't have anything like the Americans with Disabilities Act. So if you were in a wheelchair, tough luck.
They won't have you.
Or you wouldn't even have a way, you couldn't even get into the building. There were no ramps, there were no elevators, there were no automatic doors, there was nothing. Yeah, they wouldn't help you, exactly. But, you know, a lot of things were bad and we're fixing them. And so anyway, it's the base is 54 centimeters tall, stored in Campana Gallery in the Louvre Museum. And so, again, these things show up in museums. It's not in the Parthenon Museum, it's in France. Anyway, concept of having one side represent war and the other representing peace is very intriguing to me. It signifies contrast in humanity, one that is focused entirely on war and famine, and the other about peace and tranquility. We want to talk about peace too when we talk about Rome, because that's an idea that kind of started to catch on. Those concepts cannot live together in harmony, as the base suggests, characters themselves seem to serve not as much as meaning. I wonder if that was done on purpose or not. As far as the composition goes, I love the black and gold look. The designs in top and bottom rows of the piece are very well done and complement the piece well. And so these are, again, opinions about how this was put together. These are formal elements and how it was put together, and that's all good. That's what that second paragraph was supposed to be about. In Odysseus on the Neobid Crater by Timothy J. McNiven, the author describes the Neobid Crater itself. The ambiguity of the scenes comes from the large number of figures and the lack of action or iconographical evidence to help in their identification. And that's kind of a stumbling block for archaeologists and art historians. Just saying, because a lot of stuff is not marked. And so anyway, he writes, he, as I am, is very curious about the identity of the characters on the base, who they are and what they truly mean. He finds them very mysterious. The author does not use many opinions directly in his work, if any at all. I couldn't find anything else except that this described this particular piece in depth, though. The scene on the crater is particularly important because of its complexity and monumental quality, and perhaps it also its failures as a work of art, he describes. I agree with him here, since the scene is pretty much the artwork itself. Without it, it's just the large ordinary base. I will not lie, the scene makes the piece entirely. Other than that, he just goes in more depth about the painting, piece's meaning. So that ends my essay. And so,
since the artwork is mysterious, do you think the artist made that perfect just for us to figure out what it represents or the meaning of the
Well, art? You know, yeah, it's kind of hard to know that. It's kind of hard to figure all of that out. And so every once in a while, we get some ideas that they test and sometimes they prove. Talking about which, I saw something recently on Queen Nefertiti. And it caught my attention, not only because I like this Egyptian stuff. The guy who was talking about it is a guy named Dr. Aidan Dotson. And he's a friend of a friend. My friend in Truman. Yeah, every once in a while I see people that know my friend Sarah Orrell, and they would come all the way over from England or Egypt and talk. They would come visit, give lectures. I've been blessed. But anyway, Dotson, Aiden was talking about, he thinks he knows what happened to Nefertiti. And it's his theory that because we can't find Nefertiti's tomb, we know about Akhenaten, the dad, we know about Tut, the son. He believes that Tut, because he died young, was moved into a tomb that was constructed for Nefertiti. And that Nefertiti, after Tut died, kind of became an outsider. She was no longer in power. And they found this mummy that he thinks is Nefertiti. And they're undergoing DNA analysis to see if they can't link them up to King Tut and Akhenaten. Just saying. But things, like I said, happen all the time. It's like, it's pretty exciting, actually.
Recently, I didn't know they never found her body. I thought it was with...
I know, I didn't know that either.
I recently saw a video of people open and like a casket from an Egypt family that was like about the same time of when King Tut died and whatnot. It was pretty interesting.
Yeah.
It's like a casket.
Yeah. I think I got it though. Can you guys see that at home?
I don't think so.
There we go. Sure. Thank you. You see it now? The Roman Empire?
Yep.
Okay. And slideshow from the beginning. Take it from the top. So anyway, I just wanted to say that overall, these were good. There were a few that had no submission. And I'd like, if you're one of those people, to give me an email and tell me why it was. you didn't get it in, and we'll see what we can do. There were two of these that were on the standard of Ur, which were kind of good, but they weren't in the chapters that we were looking at. So anyway, I wrote that in there, and that's about everything. Are we good? We gonna move on?
Yep.
All right. The Roman Empire. And so this is a map of basically Europe and North Africa and parts of the Middle East. It's that square right there and that part of the globe. I want you to kind of take a look at this. This is at the death of Trajan in 117 Common Era. Now, Roman Empire goes back, at least as part of the city, as a city state, goes back to 500 BCE. And that was called the Republic, the Roman Republic. And so, talking about things that last through the centuries, one of our political parties call themselves Republican.
So a politician came from Roman? Not Roman, Rome?
Oh, Republic. The idea and the term came from, actually it came from Plato, a Greek philosopher, but the Romans embraced it, as did a lot of Etruscans too. And these were all city-states, and they were republics. Do you guys know what republic actually means in its real sense?
No.
Okay. It means that people are governing themselves.
Oh.
And so we got democracy where people vote for their leaders, but the idea of people actually governing themselves is the idea of a republic. So they really kind of fit together quite nicely. In the early part of this country, people like Thomas Jefferson called themselves Democratic Republicans. And they finally dropped the Republican part off, and then in mid-century, mid-19th century, people like Abraham Lincoln came along and called themselves the Republican Party.
What's the Democrat
Republican? Democrat means that you vote. Republic means people govern themselves, as opposed to having a king govern you.
So basically, you voting for yourself and voting for...
Yeah, you have, exactly. You have a say in who your leaders are, and you govern yourself. That's quite different than a monarchy, where the king or queen or the pharaoh, the monarch, governs the people. Or as they talk about today in like places like Russia, oligarchy, which is a group of very wealthy and powerful people that govern the country.
So
or a dictatorship that there's somebody just kind of usurp power.
So if you're wealthy in Russia, that means you have power. Basically, you like your own, like let's say you like yourself like own dictator or leader because they're wealthy. It's like that in Russia?
Yeah, pretty much. And there's a qualification to that, and that is that if you're rich, you probably are part of that oligarchy. But if like somebody like Putin, who's the head oligarch, doesn't like you, they'll take away your money and throw you out of the country. That's actually happened. There was a guy that owned the Russian oil company. Okay. Yeah, and you know, they own different things. You know, some people own metal, some guys own aluminum, some guys own different things. Anyway, yeah, it threw him out. Just took his money and said, oh.
That's kind of sad.
Well, it's, yeah. But the Roman Republic, and, you know, it was kind of a democracy. It wasn't a complete democracy, though. Not everybody could vote. They were slave owners. They were, as a matter of fact, this area in here, Croatia, Romania, and so on.
Is that supposed to say split?
Yeah. Yeah, and that's in modern day Kosovo, I believe. Anyway, or Croatia, yeah.
Oh, God.
Yeah, there's another town over here called Bihać, B-I-H-A-C, which is like my name, except the O is turned into an I, which I'm getting at because that's where my people come from.
Really?
And, yeah, and in Poland, in Russia, Romania, Croatia, all of this area, they are known as Slavic people.
Oh, okay. I didn't
know that. And the word for slave comes from that because this is an area where the Romans would go capture people and bring them back to be slaves in Rome.
Is that where slavery kind of started?
Slavery, as far as we know, has been with us as much as we know about civilization, because we know about slaves in Egypt as well. We're kind of still trying to figure this out, but the Bible said that the Egyptians enslaved the Jewish people until Moses led his people out of Egypt. And so, yeah, and there are different things in the Bible that talk about slaves, obey your masters. There are things about, a lot of things in the Bible about this Roman government, this Roman rule of the time. They talk about the money. They use Roman money. They're in Jerusalem, which is like way over here, still part of the Roman Empire. Pontius Pilate put Jesus on the cross. He was a Roman magistrate. So one of the things that I talked about this afternoon and is so true here is that one of the things that the Romans did well was that they were organizers. And so a town, even or a city, even as big as Rome, could occupy and maintain an empire this large. And they organized like nobody ever had before. And we find a lot of those records too, you know, of how they organized things and how young men from Gaul, which is modern day France, how they could serve in the military and gain Roman citizenship. They talk about how much they got paid. If they were in the military for 20 years, then they got a lifelong pension. Just different. We know about this stuff. It's like amazing. And so they were organizers and they were builders. And here is a mock-up, a model of what we think Rome looked like in the 4th century Common Era, in the 300s. This is about where the end of the chapter is. And then we go to Byzantine art. But this is pretty amazing. It's pretty well built. I mean, it's they got here, there's the Colosseum. This right here, Circus Maximus.
What's that?
I'm glad you asked that question. It was a place where they would have horse racing events and stuff. You ever see those films? You see them from occasional time to time when they show Roman stuff. chariot races.
Is it like those two horses in the front that carry like a cage and just like that?
Or? That is correct. Yeah, you'd have multiple horses in a chariot, which is an animal-drawn, horse-drawn vehicle with two wheels. And they would have chariot races. If you ever get a chance and you want to look at old movies, movies as old as I am, by the way, Ben-Hur from the 1950s, Charlton Heston, Ben-Hur, and he's in the chariot races. And they're here at the Circus Maximus. And the Roman guy cheated because he put these things on his wheels.
Those spiky things, yeah.
Anyway, here's a Colosseum, and this has quite a history as well. It's kind of the granddaddy, and it's kind of the model for a lot of stadiums that have been built through the years. We talk about some of these places as the Los Angeles Coliseum and so on. The design of it is, I like to bring this up, is similar to the old Busch Stadium that was downtown.
Oh, yeah.
And there were a lot of baseball stadiums built in the 60s that looked just like it. Riverfront Stadium, Three Rivers Stadium, and so on. Anyway, I'm a baseball guy, so. But at any rate, they were builders. And this piece, it's early in the chapter, this is a good example of the influence of both Greek and Etruscan art. And the roof and the fact that it doesn't fit all of those geometric proportions like we just read about, that's kind of an Etruscan thing. They weren't into it that much, doing mathematics as a way of getting to the divine. And it does look very Greek. It has the columns with the Ionic capitals. And so it's Roman, and it's 75 BCE. So it's kind of late, but it shows influence of all three of those cultures, which is why it's in the book. And most Roman ruins kind of look like this. And this is the Temple of Vesta. The Roman Senate looks like this too. And the reason a lot of this stuff looks so in such poor shape is because Rome had been attacked. They held power for 400 years, and then all of these places, like up here, you know, these are the people like the Vandals, which is where we get the word vandalism, the Huns, all kind of people coming down and tearing it down, stealing, so on. And so this is in Pompeii, and this is an amphitheater, and it's similar to what we saw in Greece, except for it's a complete circle with two semicircular halves, and the activity goes down here. But they realized the same thing, that if you created a shape like this, sound could carry out. And so, as I said, with the Greeks, no amplifiers. They had to kind of, if they were going to perform, orate, sing, whatever, this was the best configuration. And so the other part of this is that this is from Pompeii. And Pompeii, this is circa 70 BCE. In 79 AD or CE, Common Era, Mount Vesuvius blew up. He sees 8079 beast or common era. This is, they think this was like one of the newest things, but Mount Vesuvius blew up and buried this under megatons of ash. And it went real quick. It went almost like a nuclear bomb from what we can tell. They're finding people who were the corpses in the streets as they dug this up. Now it stayed untouched until this century. We just knew it was there, but in the last 50 years or so, they've been excavating this and they found that much of this is in pristine condition. And so when we talk about Roman painting, we're almost always talking about Roman painting from Pompeii because it's what survives. And so these are houses and this is, say, peristyle house of the Veti, Pompeii. So this is what they're finding. And I wanted to show you, here is a painting, and it's kind of in rough shape, and it's from Pompeii. And what we were talking about a moment ago, about violence, this is in roughly, you know, the year 75 or so, 60 to 79, common era. And so this is the amphitheater, and these are the gladiators fighting it out. But it also looks like the violence kind of spilled over into the street. Look at all of these people just running around. This looks like a riot going on. And there's something here too that I want to, this, I didn't notice this before. This cloth. I want to tell you about it here.
Is that where like kings and queens would be under and watch in the ring?
Yeah, in the arena, yeah. And so anyway, I got this. I wanted to show you, and it is the site, the website for Pompeii. And so accept the cookies, and now it translates into English. It tells you about the exhibit cell have, and that is an example of the painting. And this is like right up to date because I was kind of knocking around on this site. And it talked about wearing masks and stuff. So Italy got hit pretty hard with the COVID. And so it's got all the times, it's got the exhibitions. Description of Mount Vesuvius blowing up. And so on. Pompeii and the Etruscans, so on. And so.
Have you heard of Nero?
Yeah. Can you guys see this at home? Pompeii website?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Always got to check because his Zoom is kind of funny. But at any rate, this is, Pompeii is like beautiful, and it gives us a good look at what Rome was like. Here is Maison Carrée, which means square house, I believe, and it's in southern France. And the reason I wanted you to see this. One is that this is truly Roman style. It's got the Corinthian capitals, and it borrows quite heavily from Greek architecture, to be sure. But it's in France. And that is really kind of important. It's an important thing to know, because I was saying about how the Romans were well organized. They didn't just conquer these places. They actually strove to make life better where they conquered. And I'll show you something here. The markets of Trajan, looking northeast. And this, they made, this is the Colosseum we'll talk about. I got so much to talk about, I'm getting all mixed up. Here we go. So this is in France as well. And they built this, you know what it's called, anybody?
A bridge?
It's kind of like a bridge, but not exactly.
Is it Pont de Gard?
Pont de Gard, yes. And it's looking east, and it is an aqueduct. And aqua is water, like an aquarium. A duct, they talk about that in anatomy. We talk about that even in the building trades. You have duct work in here, bringing the air from the furnace to heat the room, duct work to return the cold air, duct work. It's something that carries something else. And in this case, the duct carries water. And what the Romans, and they were engineers like out of this world. They built these things so that they could carry fresh water into these places where they were building cities. And so anyway, they weren't getting the water from here. The water was coming from far away, sometimes hundreds of miles away. They were getting the water largely from the mountains, where you find, you ever see those beer commercials? They talk about clean mountain water. Why do you think Busch beer has a mountain on its logo? Coors beer, you know, mountains are famous for having this pure, clean water. And basically, if you can get it from the mountains down to the cities, your cities will thrive. There's just a few things that a city needs to survive. One of them is water. And the other is food. But if you've got enough water coming out, you can irrigate your fields in a place that was maybe not even habitable. That's not just, that was a Roman idea. And they got the water from the Alps, and they had this aqueduct, and it was on a very, very, very subtle downhill grade. And so they knew that if it kept downhill, it kept going downhill over a long period, or a long distance, I should say, that they could deliver the water. They wouldn't need pumps or anything like that. And so this has a very subtle downhill slope, and that explains why this is like a bridge, because the mountains, say, back here, 10, 50 miles, 100 miles. But when they came to a place like this, if the water came down, you couldn't get it back up. So that's why this side has to be higher, and this other side maybe being just a tiny bit lower. But the idea of being able to engineer that in ancient times, over hundreds of miles, is remarkable. And they were such good builders that a lot of these aqueducts still exist. They're still here. We can go see them. You can visit this. And so one of the things that Romans did, they borrowed this from the Etruscans. We saw this, the arch. And this is that formula that we figured out, that this is like 1.6 times the diameter. And so you spread out the weight of this over a longer distance, which makes it a lot stronger. And so they were builders, they were engineers, and the idea of doing this still persists today. We don't use an aqueduct, we use pipes and pipelines. How about Las Vegas, Nevada? Las Vegas, that's built in a place that should not even be habitable. It's in the middle of the desert, no water source. So what do? They dam up the Colorado River. They make a lake. The lake gives hydroelectric power, and they siphon water. And that is really two things that you need to build a modern day city. You need utilities, and water and electric are primary. And so the Romans had this same kind of idea. Of course, they weren't dealing with the middle of the desert or anything, but they were taking care of people. And I want to throw this out because we were talking about war and peace and stuff. During this time, the Romans, and they were basically all over this whole place. They had minor skirmishes. You know, we know about that. We know about that in the historical record. We even know about that in the Bible, that Pilate was going to let someone go when he was going to crucify Jesus, and they wanted, the crowd yelled, Barabbas, let him go. He was a radical Jewish separatist. And so anyway, we knew he was part of the resistance there. We know about some other things that happened in the Holy Land and around, but basically they had peace. One of the things that happened with Roman rule was that a lot of these people that would have probably attacked each other a lot didn't. Romans were in charge. And they call that the Pax Romana, the peace, Pax, Rome, Romana. And so anyway, yeah, and so they kept the peace in a lot of ways, and you know, providing water and stuff, always a good thing. And they also will find amphitheaters and other places and other kinds of entertainment menus all around the Roman Empire. We find amphitheaters all over the place. And the Romans believed that if you kept the population happy, you can keep the peace. And it's a lot easier keeping the peace than it is fighting wars with everybody. And so that was especially true in the city of Rome itself. And this is the Colosseum, known as the Flavian Amphitheater. And this is in this, they don't go very deep into this in the book, and it's kind of a shame, but this is an architectural marvel. It's got inside of it all of this, this network under the center of the amphitheater that was used to stage the events that the Roman people watched, were entertained with. And so underneath this, the center of this, there were cages and cells, and there were all kinds of different things. They could seal off the center and fill it up with water and have mock naval battles. And so that was big enough that they could fill it up, put a couple of ships on there, and they would fight. Gladiators often performed in the Colosseum, and those were fights to the death. And so that's kind of like we were talking about, the brutality was still there. And later, when Christianity started to threaten the Roman Empire, or they felt threatened by it, they started feeding Christians to the lions, or torturing them, or doing other horrible things for their entertainment in this Colosseum. There's a story about how for a long time, people would go on pilgrimages to Rome, and they often went to the Colosseum and took a handful of sand back with them, because they thought that in that sand was the blood of the early Christians who were killed in this place. They did all kinds of things. They were an empire. They would bring exotic animals. It was like a circus, modern day circus, and they would bring in the elephants and the giraffes and the tigers and lions and gorillas and stuff just to entertain the population. And it's been said that in the early days it was more civil, but as time went on, it became more brutal. And so anyway, I want to show you this too. Kind of pass this. Oh, yeah. Here is one of the engineering feats of Rome. Concrete. Always talk about, they use what they have in where they're at. And so they use certain building materials in Egypt and in Greece. They had a lot of marble, and so they made tons of things out of marble. When we get to Rome, they don't really have those resources that you find in other places. And so what they do is they come up with the idea of concrete, which is basically lime, sand, and water, and some rocks. And so they invent this. And then they find out that they could mold it into different things. And so these are all concrete arches. And they found out that they could hold a lot of weight, and they were a lot more easy to construct than trying to bricklay an arch, and especially something like this that would require much brickwork. They can just pour concrete. And this is a hemispherical dome with oculus, which is this. This is an oculus, which is a hole in the roof. And they found out that this is something you really can't do with bricks. You need that center point to kind of help distribute the weight all the way down. Bottom line, concrete made all of this possible. And we still use it that way today. We use concrete forms and we do a lot of things with pre-made concrete and lime. Lime is the big ingredient. That's what you need to have. And do you know that right here in River City, we have one of the biggest lime deposits in the whole world. It's just right here in St. Genevieve, Missouri. If you go there, it's pretty much the local industry, and it's called Mississippi Lime Company. And the mines, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, because I work at a store that they sell the bags of Mississippi lime, like the hydrated and
yes.
This type of stuff.
Everything lime. Exactly. Yeah, I got cousins that work down there too. It's huge. And so anyway, you go with what you have. Actually, there was a lot of clay in this area too. And St. Louis itself was one of the major brick making centers 100 years ago. You want to know why we have all these brick homes, especially in the old part of town, like Lafayette Square and so on, Soulard. Anyway, one more thing. This, and it's a star. This is the Pantheon. Excuse me, I'm getting so mixed up. It's the Pantheon, not to be confused with the Parthenon. Pantheon means a house of many gods. Pan means many or across a wide range. Theon, just like monotheism, polytheism, etc. And so anyway, this is it. And this is truly Roman design. You can see what they borrowed from the Greeks up here in front. And they got the Corinthian columns, which is truly what Romans love to use. It has this in front. Of course, it's got some other bronze ornamentation on the top, but this is an Egyptian obelisk. So this is kind of celebrates much of the ancient cultures and their architecture. And let me show you. This is a cutaway version. It's huge. And this is what it looks like. This is a photograph. This is not a painting or a mock-up. This is how big it is. And you can see the scale by how big these people are. And you can see what kind of shape it's in. It's pristine. It has been in constant use for 2,000 years or nearly. There's the oculus. It's the hole in the roof, and it does a number of things. One, it lets light in. Secondly, it lets heat out. And one of the things that is kind of a drawback is that when it rains, rain comes in. But it's so high up that the rain dissipates before it hits the floor. In fact, it usually just turns into humidity. And so we have all of these. This is the Roman dome. We see a lot of Roman architecture here. And around the edge, there are these naves, these places where they sometimes have a statue, sometimes a door, sometimes some inscription. This also serves as a mausoleum. There are people buried in this place. Some ancient notables buried in here. The painter Raphael died in 1520. Common era, buried in here, just saying. And so anyway, And if you take a look at this, and you take a look at, say, the Jefferson Memorial in Washington, D.C., you'll see quite a lot of similarity. And out here is a fountain. And one of the things I want to point out is that as though, just like the Romans brought water to all of these places around Europe from the Alps, they also brought a lot of water into Rome itself. And so they were well equipped to just build fountains and play with water a lot. They had Roman baths, and it would be constantly, it was kind of a spa kind of thing. But bottom line is that they had tons. They had tons of clean, pure water, and they had the engineering. They had the building skills. They had concrete, and that is Roman architecture. I guess we can start on Monday with the triumphal arch. And so, any questions?
Oh, I have a question.
Yes, yes.
Do they have, what do you call it, a freak circus back then?
Oh, yeah, yes, yeah, they would. I don't exactly know what they call it, but yeah, they would do a lot of things. And we're talking about freak circuses that lasted in here in the United States until, you know, probably 75 years ago. But they would have people who were suffered from dwarfism and different kinds of abnormalities and what we might call deformities and stuff. And yeah, Romans were big on stuff like that. That kind of maintained itself for a long time too. And we'd even in Barnum and Bailey's circus, they would have these exhibits like the bearded lady and stuff like that, you know. And that comes out of this Roman spectacle. And that's how they entertained themselves, and it lasted a long time. And so it's time to say, have a good weekend. And we'll pick it up on Monday. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a question or just like a statement for you.
Okay, run that by me again.
I just have to like tell you something because you had talked about the quiz and I was one of the people that didn't submit it on time.
Yeah.
I tried to Monday night and then I looked back at it last night and it said that it hadn't submitted and then like it wouldn't let me turn it back in. So I commented on like submission and rubric on Canvas.
Isabel?
Do what?
Are you Isabel?
I'm Maggie.
Maggie, okay. I'm trying to get through my people here.
You're good.
Maggie Zimmerman.
Yes.
Okay. Send it to me as an email attachment.
Okay.
You're not the first one to talk about Canvas having some malfunctions.
It was weird.
Yeah, and so anyway, send it to me and I'll put it in, I'll grade it and give you a grade and we'll be good.
Okay, thank you.
We'll be happy and I will too.
Okay, thank you.
You too, see you.
Thank you.
You good. Bye. Again.
See you Monday.
All right. So, can you do that for me, Maggie? We're gone. All right. Stop recording.